Okay, I think we'll get started. Distinguished ladies and gentlemen, colleagues, students, friends all, good morning and welcome to the Institute for Gender and Development Studies, Mona Unit, public lecture on human trafficking. I am Dr. Jessica Dunn, and I'm going to be your moderator for this morning's session. Did I wish you a happy new year? I don't know about you, but I'm increasingly feeling uncomfortable wishing people Happy New Year because the year is just flying. It's whisking by, right? So I said good morning and I'll leave it at that. But I do wish you a Happy New Year. I hope it's a good year for all of us. I'm very excited personally in terms of being here today. It's the first time I'm actually able, I lived abroad for many years, and it's the first time I'm having the opportunity to participate in Research Days series, which is an annual series at UWI. And I feel great anticipation and excitement. Research excites me, and so I'm delighted to be able to be here with you today and to participate in Research Days. As a proud graduate of the UWI as well, I also worked on faculty with the University of Nottingham for a number of years. And I recall fondly that the research showcase season that we had there was always a breath of fresh air. We tend to reside in academia in our micro-academic world, and that we do that for much of the year. So this is an opportunity to experience the interdisciplinarity that exists and to discover research interests that are common and research connections across disciplines. Research inquiry, in my mind, is of immeasurable value, and it is an essential ingredient for national development. It's reassuring to know, as well as we participate in Research Days, that we are not embracing these absurd notions of alternative facts. Anybody heard of that? And this notion of a post-truth era that we're existing in here at the UWI, so celebrating that too. Allow me at this time to convey apologies for Reverend Dr. Margaret Fowler, who was the speaker originally identified and scheduled for this lecture, and also for Dr. Leith Dunn, the head of the Institute for Gender and Development Studies. Both could not be here today due to medical reasons, but they both have asked that I send you all their greetings and best wishes. We are lucky today to have with us Mrs. Indy McClymont Lafayette. Indy's a consultant, and I think she will introduce herself a little later on in more detail, and somebody I think has been appointed to introduce her. But Indy was part of a national study spearheaded by Dr. Leith Dunn and the Mona unit specifically to review trafficking in persons. There was a study conducted by Ricketts and Dunn in 2007, and in 2015-16 that study was updated. And so some of the findings that will be shared in Mrs. Lafayette's presentation will go into drilling down into that detail. Okay. Mrs. Lafayette will also look specifically at human trafficking and the culture of silence in Jamaica surrounding trafficking. So we apologize to persons who came specifically to hear about social justice and the social justice response to human trafficking, which would have been Reverend Dr. Fowler's focus, based on what you saw in the advertising for the event. But today's lecture will not be on that topic, but as I said, on the culture of silence in human trafficking. All right, so I'm going to start off just giving a brief overview of the content of the study, what was conducted, as I mentioned, in 2015-16 by Dr. Dunn. Okay, so the objective of this study was to briefly, can you still hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Briefly explain the nature and extent of human trafficking in Jamaica. So as I mentioned, it was an update to the 2007 published study, and one that was commissioned by the National Task Force Against Trafficking in Persons, NATFATIP. The study also was funded by the Ministry of Justice and the United Nations. Just some images to conjure up in our minds what we mean when we talk about trafficking. Often we're talking about children, we're talking about women, and we're talking terms of the global landscape, the United States Department of State has provided this map. I mean, this is a little dated. I'm not sure if they've published this map in its more updated situation, but it categorizes countries of the world in accordance with their ranking system in terms of the degree of gravity or prevalence of human trafficking from tiers 1 to 3. Jamaica, as you many of you would be aware, at one point was on the tier 2 watch list, which was of great concern. A number of activities have emerged demonstrating the developments in our understanding of human trafficking in the local context, as well as in terms of the ratification of the Palermo Protocol. This was a convention that was updated in 2000, looking at protecting the rights of those who are vulnerable to human trafficking. Jamaica has also established, as many of you know, the NACFATIP, which is now coordinating the implementation of anti-trafficking programs linked to prevention, prosecution, and protection for various stakeholders or people involved in the process. The country has also developed a national strategic plan and is developing a policy and updating that. We have also developed a curriculum for high school, so students at the secondary level are now being introduced to what human trafficking is, and there's a sensitization drive that is being advanced as well. We have also passed and updated an anti-trafficking legislation, and we have strengthened and expanded some of the institutional partnerships to help in this drive towards prevention, protection, and prosecution. Okay, as part of this study, the NACFATIP information database, which was an integrated database, this was designed under the leadership again of Dr. Dunn and pilot tested by her research team based on the International Organization for Migration model, the IOM model, very established and very robust as a model in terms of building a database of this kind. Feedback, of course, was solicited and suggested revisions incorporated to ensure that it was fit for purpose for the Jamaican context. A data sharing protocol and brochure were also developed to support the database and provide public education around its use, and the Ministry of Justice and UNDP, as I mentioned, funded this very important project, and they're now at the stage of determining how it will be operationalized, how we will integrate the various streams of data that are available in different institutions, entities, ministries, departments, and agencies. Okay. The database project, up to the point it was completed in 2016, involved a review and listing of databases that were already in existence in Jamaica, in the Ministry of Justice, the Jamaica Constabulary Force, the Office for the Children's Registry, and the Director of Public Prosecution's Office as well. A number of the strategies for data collection and integration included interviews and focus groups with members of NACFATIP, all who are acutely focused on trafficking and its eradication or reduction in Jamaica, consultations with representatives from various vulnerable groups, which we are aware of based on the research that has been ongoing, poverty maps from the PIOJ Statin Geoinformatics, so even statistical data coming in through and being mapped in terms of poverty and where some of the predispositions to trafficking might exist, and an international migration task force data set was also used in its development. And of course, driving this process, we had involved an IT specialist who works in database management systems. So the assessment included, the assessment included four components, a literature review, and I won't go into too much detail here, given that Ms. Lafayette will go into that later, interviews with members of the NACFATIP and partner agencies, focus group discussions, again, with members of NACFATIP, partner agencies, but also with the inclusion of faith-based organizations. So Reverend Dr. Fowler, who could not be here today, was centrally involved in that component of the study, the FBOs, and what they had to say and what their perceptions were of human trafficking. There were also specific consultations with vulnerable groups, including the LGBT communities, MSMs, sex workers association, media houses, and a number of others, which you can see listed in this slide. Okay. In terms of the aspects of human trafficking that were detected in this update, as I mentioned, it was consistent with global trends, so that we have seen an increase in human trafficking globally. Again, as people become more aware, the reporting of cases and so on also increases. So we should be mindful of that as we interpret the information. But the main type of human trafficking identified in these studies globally, and what we found in this study, continued to be for commercial sexual exploitation. Okay. There are a number of new cases of child trafficking reported, many of which, again, are associated with commercial sexual exploitation. Okay. The Office of the Children's Registry reported 1,000%, imagine that, increase in child trafficking from 5 cases to 55 between 2013 and 14. Again, bearing in mind the increase in the reporting. All parishes except 2 have double-digit rates per 1,000, I think, capita of reports reflecting a high incidence of child abuse. And Sisoka, affiliated to the JCF, noted that while the total number of reports on child abuse spanned several parishes, the parishes with the highest number were Westmorland, Trelawney, and St. Anne. In terms of a comparative analysis of data between the 2007 study and the 2016, major risk factors for TIP include, of course, gender. We can see that there's a tilt towards being female and being young. Yeah, so the younger you are, the more predisposed. Poverty makes people more vulnerable. Political climate and maybe perhaps the lack of sensitization and awareness around human trafficking at leadership levels. And environmental predispositions as well. And in environmental, we should consider the technology and the access that young people are having increasingly to technology. This is where a lot of traffickers prey. And so when we talk about environmental, we're not just talking the physical context, but also the technological spaces that we have online and so on. So the data from both the primary and secondary research conducted confirmed that females are more at risk, and female commercial sex workers, of course, far more predisposed. Female masseuses apply for jobs but are deceived, coerced, and forced to have sex with clients as a condition of their employment. As a group, they've not been specifically sensitized about human trafficking. Adolescent girls under 18 years were featured prominently among reports on missing persons in the JCF statistics and in media reports. And we all have heard about Amanda Alert and some of the cases that have been coming up in that. We see that the lower the socioeconomic background, the more predisposed. Increased access and use of computers and ICTs, and the increased use of social media networks, as I mentioned before. We can just move over that. Okay. All right, so just to highlight some of the policy recommendations, the results of various studies point to a clear need for all MDAs to collaborate. Okay, and this is part of why the database study was developed, to facilitate that integration and collaboration. And then revisions to the legislation are also necessary. Okay. These are just some flags for you now in terms of, go back, what you can do in terms of getting involved. So the National Task Force for or Against Trafficking in Persons, they have a secretariat. You can go on their website and look up to find out more about human trafficking. A key contact, which I was asked to alert you to, is Ms. Keisha West, who is based at the Ministry of Justice, and DCP Berry from the Jamaica Constabulary Force. So you can get involved, and these are some of the contacts that you can make. Also, I was asked to ensure that you are aware of the important work that Reverend Dr. Fowler is doing
in the Theodora Project and Skills Center in Negril. So this is a nonprofit organization with the mission to empower young people at high risk of being exploited in human trafficking and to provide them with skills and education so they can sustain themselves. Okay. You can also, apparently Theodora is on Facebook, so you can look them up. It's the Theodora Skills Center. And if you are interested in getting involved, making a contribution to building that work, you can get in touch with Mrs. Williamson at Reverend Dr. Margaret Fowler's office, and the number is reflected here as well. Thank you. Okay, as we move through the program, I'm going to now invite Dr. Ajo Onura, the acting head of the Institute for Gender and Development Studies Mona Unit, to share some greetings.
Okay, I'm hoping that persons can, everybody can hear me. Put the mic a little higher. No, because I'm going to have to, okay. A pleasant good morning and a warm welcome. There's a trick to it. Maybe I'll just use this one. Okay. Pleasant good morning, and this mic is low, but I'll try to protect my voice. Warm welcome to, I don't see any university officials here, but I'm just going to do the courtesies of welcoming them in spirit. Special guests, members of the UWI community and general public. Delighted to have you here to participate in and share in our annual Research Day signature event being hosted by the Institute for Gender and Development Studies. Thank you for coming. That many of you are here so early in the morning when you could have chosen other competing events happening at the same time is a testament to the importance of the work that we're doing here at the Institute for Gender and Development Studies. So I want to, you know, thank you once again for coming. So we here at the IGDS are committed to promoting gender-sensitive development in all sectors with the goal of actively raising awareness about issues that affect persons along various social identity markers. We're engaged in a program of teaching, research, outreach, and publications with the goal of equipping persons with knowledge and skills to become change agents, to transform inequitable power structures, institutions that affect their daily lives. This year, our public lecture centers around the theme or the topic of the global human trafficking, and it's entitled A Social Justice Response to Human Trafficking in Jamaica. We're honored to have here with us our guest speaker, Mrs. Indy McClyman Lafayette, an esteemed specialist in the area of development communications, who brings with her passion, knowledge, and expertise, having worked as part of the IGDS Mona Unit research team headed by Dr. Leith Dunn. So prepare yourselves, members of the audience, to be engaged, excited, and inspired. And with that, I'll hand over to the video presentation is what happens next. Thank you.
Michelle, what shall I do in my emotions? Trafficking in persons by law is a criminal offense. Those who perpetrate this crime usually do so in unsuspecting ways. It could be a friendly invitation to another part of the the island or another country, or even through enticing job offers. Persons who get caught up in this web aren't necessarily naive individuals, but human traffickers are sophisticated criminals who put a lot of thought into disguising their nefarious intents.
Not all persons who promise jobs but with sexual lessons after graduation can deliver or plan to deliver. So what they do is lure them into thinking that there's a better life somewhere else. And persons who respond to it, what they do is that they pay the ticket and they invite you off. Once you're there, they take the passports and then you're placed in solitude.
It is at this helpless stage that victims are forced into unpaid labor or prostitution. The best way to get out of these situations is not to enter them in the first place. So the authorities are cautioning persons to be more vigilant.
You are not supposed to get a visa without your attending or that your parents, if you're a minor, right? So nobody is supposed to be able to legitimately give you a passport without a valid visa, without your having gone through that process.
Before you even reach that stage, you should try to get answers to some very important questions once an offer has been made to you. Ask, where am I going? Where will I be staying? Who will be responsible for me? And what do I tell my family?
If you cannot give that information out of this encounter that you're offering, you cannot give that information that can be checked, then you are not to take it. Facts on trafficking to the workers in the sector who would be exposed, customs, immigration, the police. So at the moment you get into your pocket and you have the facts, this is what I'm saying.
We can identify persons being trafficked by certain behaviors in this way. A person behaving unusually timid is one of the classic signs of someone being trafficked.
Persons who are leaning on to this adult, you know, not like a parent-child kind of arrangement, but almost like you're kidnapped, but you are afraid to let anybody know that this is your situation. We have to look out for those people who have no confidence.
I like the moment send up information to the people. It's hung in my head. From now on, I'm not taking anything for granted. I'm so sure with the video.
No problem, man. We have to share information. This is one way of ending the cycle.
This information-based strategy by the government is a positive approach with citizens that seeks to preserve and enhance a secure and protective environment for all. Now that we have the information, let us use it to our advantage. Our main source of protection against trafficking in persons is to be aware of the effects.
Very interesting, eh? Compelling. Okay, I'm going to tell you a little bit more about Mrs. Indy McClymont Lafayette. She is a multi-award-winning journalist and communications specialist with over 18 years of experience in media and communications. She was affiliated at one point as executive director at the Panos Caribbean. And there, she honed her expertise in communications for development with a significant focus on the environment, HIV, AIDS, child rights, and on gender. Over her 11 years full-time employment with Panos, she held a range of positions, and as I mentioned, including in the last 4 years as executive director. Prior to Panos, she was the coordinator or editor of the Jamaica Observer's All-Woman magazine, which all of us are familiar with. And over the years, she has done extensive coverage of environmental health and gender issues. She has received nine national and regional awards for her work in those areas, including the Pan American Health Organization's Merit Award for Excellence in Health Journalism in the Caribbean, the United Nations Population Fund 2003 Caribbean Media Awards, and the Platinum Award for coverage of adolescent and reproductive health issues. PAHO's CARICOM Award for the best story on HIV/AIDS is yet another of her many honorifics and achievements. A Jamaica Government Exhibition Scholarship recipient as well, Mrs. Lafayette holds a Bachelor of Arts in Media and Communications with honors and a Master of Arts in Counseling, in Counseling Psychology. Displaying a range of multidisciplinary skills, Mrs. Lafayette has lectured at the tertiary level since 2010, where she co-lectured the intervention design course for master students at the Caribbean Institute for Media and Communications here at the UWI. And while from 2013 to the present, she has lectured a course on gender, climate change, and disasters for undergraduate students at the IGDS. In association with Panos and IGDS, her involvement was solicited in this in-depth report on human trafficking, which she will talk about today. In addition to her journalistic work, she has also written and co-edited three publications, a short story, Tommy, the Moko Maroon, published in the Jamaican Ministry of Education's Windows to Literacy textbook, The Voices from Moko, published on the environment and climate change by Panos Caribbean, and Climate Change, Gender, and Persons with Disabilities in Small Island Developing States. Indy is happily married to Patrick and has two children, Leela and Devon. Can I tell you from my own personal view that Indy is a warm, very warm person, and her heart is after making a difference for women who are predisposed to all kinds of vulnerabilities, in particular sex workers. So I'm very excited, and I'm sure you are too, to hear from her now. I'll call you forward now. Thank you so much.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning.
Okay, I'm just checking that it's too early for hungry, not so close to lunch yet. All right, okay, but you seem alert enough. I really am honored to be here filling in for Dr. Fowler. I really hope that she has a quick recovery, as was mentioned before, because of medical reasons she couldn't be here. And I want to thank IGDS for allowing me the opportunity to share on the research that we did in collaboration. And let me start, though, by just telling you a little bit of my first encounter with human trafficking. This was in around 2003 when I was just taking over as the all-woman coordinator at the Jamaica Observer. And I was a part of an international fellowship where they took women journalists from around the world. I think they chose 8 of us at the time, the Population Reference Bureau, and they wanted us to be trained to better incorporate gender into our reporting. So what they would do is have a one-week workshop on a variety of gender-related topics in different locations. Now, the very last of the four workshops that I went to was on human trafficking. They took us to Delhi in India. Now, that was an eye-opening experience for me, and I'm not going to tell you all the adventures, but just the main part. We went into the red light districts, we went into the brothels, and we were able to speak with a lot of the girls who had been trafficked, and this was where they were now. And it was a very heartrending is a mild word to say when you hear some of the experiences from these women. So the organizers were like, maybe we should not have carried you here, because all you women, journalists do, it was about 10 of us, is sit and cry. But we really felt it for, you know, some of the stories shared there. I remember one young girl who was partially deaf, and she said her father just carried her at about 9 or 10 and left her in the market, and the men came and took her and so on. So some of the girls had were working in the brothels, some of them had become madams and were running the brothels and so on. So it was a big eye-opener for me, and we had to also share about what was happening in our countries. So of course, me, proud Jamaican, make sure I tell them that, listen, that's not happening in Jamaica. We don't know of those things there. So, you know, I was very happy. I said I'd keep an eye out when I got back home, and if anything came up, of course I would help in reporting, but I was sure it wasn't relevant to us. So I'm back, and within a space of, I think it was 2 months, we get a press release in the newsroom that Jamaica has been demoted to tier 3 by the US. And I was like, what? Where am I again? You know, because I couldn't believe that we were being sanctioned for not dealing with human trafficking. And it was right here in my face, and I was here telling them overseas that it wasn't impacting us. And so from there, I really started to take a deeper interest in looking at some of the issues. And so it wasn't hard then when Dr. Dunn said, you know, that the study was being commissioned, that she wanted us to partner together. I want to pause and acknowledge Ms. Claudette Nolan, who was part of the research team. Thanks, Claudette, for coming this morning. Who really helped us to collect some of the testimonies and the experiences that you'll hear more about. So my first few slides will give you some background in terms of the broader project, and then I will go more into detail on the aspect that Panos Caribbean, which is a non-regional, non-government organization based in Jamaica and Haiti, you know, I'll focus on the areas that Panos zoned in on. So it was, we had a short time frame in which to do this. We were looking at 6 months, so we knew we had to do a rapid assessment. There was not a lot of time, and that's partly also why we divvied up the work. So for example, we pulled from primary and secondary sources. Panos's aspect did incorporate some literature review as well, but primarily getting primary data from sex workers, dancers, men who had sex with men, and the media. Part of the background was looking at some of the drivers, some of the things that were contributing to the environment of trafficking that we had. The economic context of the situation that faces Jamaica, which we are all aware of. Jamaica has probably one of the slowest growing economies in the Caribbean at the moment. We are finding that, you know, women especially, female-headed households are over 40% of those facing higher risk, you know, of poverty. Everybody is aware. We have further statistics in this study, so I'm just giving you a quick synopsis of some of the issues. But the crime and corruption situation that Jamaica faces, a part of the culture that we have of, you know, informer for dead, not sharing key information that would lead to prosecutions on issues like this. Because one of the things that I thought about when I was putting together the lecture is what to me was one of the key barriers facing us being able to properly tackle trafficking. And a part of that is that as much as Jamaicans are chatterboxes, some of the major and important things we don't like to talk about, like these issues. So we would rather just push it under the rug if we could, but it really is impacting our development in a variety of ways. Just touching base here in terms of also one of the good things that we saw coming out of the literature review that was done is the approach that was taken with greater push on behalf of the police force to really investigate matters surrounding trafficking in persons. Because as I told you earlier, when we got that tier three, now I don't know how many persons know what tier three means, because when you're on tier three watch list, usually a lot of the development aid that a country gets is withheld. So it's an impetus for countries to deal with ensuring that they are putting measures in place to tackle. And so the police are doing more investigations now. And here we see a little, just some data in terms of 27 investigations that were done, and 26 of those were related to sex trafficking, and one more to forced labor. A little bit of background, we've touched on the economics already. It's all across the island, as you would realize. There are some parishes, though, which I'll spend a little more time on later when I look at this panel specifics, where sex work is higher than average and than in the other parishes. Dr. Dunn spoke earlier about the age, who is at risk, the younger ladies under 25, that sort of general range. I was particularly touched looking at the, I was glad to see that there was an increase in the documenting of some of the cases of child trafficking. Because a part of the reason why I initially didn't think it was happening is because you're not hearing about it. But now we're seeing and hearing more cases coming out because people are starting to understand what child trafficking is. But you'd be surprised, and I'll come back to this, that the awareness of what trafficking is still extremely poor. And that is why people are not making the connections and maybe not feeling that urgency to do something about it because the understanding is still not so clear. So you'll see the breakdown here of the cases by parish. I mean, when we look at the data, which it continues to be so very much relevant to the issues that we are seeing now with the sexual abuse being very, very rampant in the news right now. And even up to, I think it was last night, I saw a message on WhatsApp of a young girl that had been missing for a week or so, that was taken away in a taxi and her body was found yesterday. You know, and it really hits home that we need to be doing more. And the statistics, the research is there to make the case. Based on what we are seeing, 1,000% increase in reports on child trafficking. Next slide. All right, I want to move a little bit to, go back a second. So we see Westmoreland, St. Anne and Trelawney, the breakout. I am gonna focus a little bit more on Westmoreland when we come to the issue of the sex work and trafficking. Mm-hmm. So some of the vulnerable groups that we we saw coming out of this rapid assessment that was done. The household workers continue to be an at-risk group because of a variety of factors, including for those that live in. We all know sometimes parents, you know, send your child from country maybe to go to school in a corporate area and they end up being the slave is a strong word, but doing all the domestic things in the house. We were still seeing some of those instances and cases referred to. And the recommendation was there in terms of continuing the push for the ratification of certain clauses for the decent work agenda. We found that female massage parlor workers were now the ones who were more vulnerable in terms of awareness of trafficking and being more likely to be sucked into a trafficking situation. Surprisingly or not surprisingly, men who have sex with men, there was quite a large group of those that we interviewed that had experienced trafficking. And here you see also migrant workers and unemployed job seekers. So let me touch a little bit, some of the good news, because it's a serious topic we want to sort of balance. Based on, this is coming out of the overall studies literature review. The fact that we have ratified the Palermo legislation, which governs trafficking here in Jamaica, and as Jessica had touched on, some of the initiatives that have been coming out now to have more partnerships dealing with trafficking more widely in society. So that is part of the transition and the change that we see coming up. But with the gaps, the limited scope of data collection and data in general, because it's such a secretive issue, it's not easy to get people who will talk about their experiences and what's happening. There still needs to be quite a bit of work incorporating different policies at the national level to ensure that there's a smooth system for dealing with the issues. I mean, we didn't spend a lot of time on this, but I am very concerned about some of the cultural factors that also impinge on things, because the lack of sharing of key information, as I mentioned earlier, perceptions of, you know, not trusting the justice system, because why the system now works, so it makes sense. You know, some of those thoughts and there is some validity in them, so I'm not throwing that out, but it also is a hindrance in terms of, you know, getting us to properly address the issue of trafficking. This is a big one, a lack of knowledge of TIP. We had to spend a lot of time sensitizing the persons that we were collecting the information from on what TIP was. And from our scan of the media and so on, you could still see that this is a big area that needs quite a bit of work. One of the things before I go into the JCF's work, I want to just stick a pin and share a thought with you, because with my continued exposure to the issue of trafficking, it's part of that growth is looking more analytically at some of the things we take for granted. And I want to just share it's a light thing, but for me it was a significant thing. How many persons here remember Shabarang's Trailer Load? Know that song? Of course, thank you. Now, I have a love-hate relationship with that song. And you know why? I love the beat and I love how Shaba sound on it. So you hear it and you want to start moving. But then my mind start listening to what he's saying, because I always do that with the music. And you know, one day I say, what is he really saying? Me have a trailer load of girls down a wharf, it take off. You know, just to reach down and clear them off. And I'm saying, a trailer load of girls, isn't that trafficking? If him have them down at the wharf, really seriously? Yeah. But all these years of seeing it, it never occurred to me, because I wasn't looking at it in that light. You know, and so I had to take a step back and say, it's so much a part of our culture. You don't think anything of some of these things until you start really being more critical. And so that's sort of the challenge that for this morning I'm wanting to put out to all of us. Look around and be a bit more critical, because then we can identify more of what is happening. We'll see here where the police are being much more vigilant. Dismantling 3 major prostitution rings in the corporate urban areas, Kingston, St. Catherine, St. James, rescuing 62 victims. And I think quite a few of some of this came out in the media, so the media was providing some coverage, as well as pamphlets and brochures being disseminated. Again, just breaking out according to race, the alleged traffickers, Chinese 1, Indian 3, Jamaicans, how much at 15? So, you know, also looking at the profile of that racial impact. So that is the broader frame of some of the context of the broader research project. I'm going to now go into what panel's focused on. But before I do that, I want to just throw out a question. Does everybody here know what trafficking is? Me see some people looking not so sure. All right, you don't have to put up your hand. That's why I never ask you to put up your hand. But when I was putting the slides together, I said, really and truly, you know, I should have a definition of what trafficking is in this presentation, because some of us might not want to admit it, but you might not be so clear. So it's long, but at least you have an idea. If you go out, leave in here and may ask you, so what was it all about? You can sort of tell her, you know, a bit about what trafficking is. So it has to do with the recruitment of persons, harboring them by coercive means, deception, basically giving the guise of offering employment or opportunities for advancement under false pretenses. And a lot of the times you'll see it playing out in, for example, in massage parlors, where some young ladies may legitimately think it's just a job as a masseuse. And when you get there, you find out that sex work is also a part of the job, and you're not allowed to leave if you don't wish to engage. So basically we try to, you judge based on whether or not there's coercion. You know, if the person is forced to do stuff against what they were, and deception. Those are two of the main areas that we look out for. So Panos works a lot on getting the voices of persons and entities that are not heard often, marginalized in society, into public spaces, public debate and dialogue. And what we did for this study was focus a lot on some of our key populations. Men who have sex with men, commercial sex workers, exotic dancers, and the media. And similar to the, consistent with the research methodology, we did a literature review, a media scan, several questionnaires, and interviews. We focused on the top 5 parishes most known for sex work, And as I had mentioned earlier, St. Anne, Kingston, St. Catherine, Westmoreland, those were the ones targeted. We wanted 50 interviews with female sex workers. In the end, though, we only got 35. For male sex workers, we were aiming for 30. We ended up with 20 because it's a very hard population to reach, as we had indicated earlier. And we had to use a snowballing methodology because one person had to refer to somebody else because of the difficulty of getting the population. So what we did was we had a structured questionnaire that was used, and the interviews were recorded and analyzed, you know, and some tables done and so on. So let me look first on the media scan, where we had 348 online stories from the Observer, the Gleaner, and RGR's website. We had 194 stories from the Gleaner over an 8-year span, 90 from the Observer over a 5-year span, and 64 from RGR. So what did this show us? What we did, we analyzed the headlines, the first paragraph or the lead, and then a quick scan of the body of the articles. And one of the things coming out was the low levels of conviction for trafficking offenses, because persons were, it says inadequate participation from persons who have been trafficked. And we find that some of the persons who when they went back home to their home countries or were deported, when it came to pushing forward with the court case, they had challenges getting them back. So that was one of the things that was coming out. 20% of the stories from Observer looked at trafficking and the justice system, and almost 38% from RGR looked at the same. Go ahead, Kim. Right. So for the Sunday Gleaner, this was just one of the stories that we pulled out, talking about the experiences that the police were having with pushing through for the convictions, and a judge was, you know, just a quote from Justice Gloria Smith about the challenges they were facing. One article in the Observer called for increased support services for persons trafficked or sexually exploited, and some of that also was underscored by Mrs. Lisa Palmer Hamilton, who called for strengthening of the legislative framework. And we have touched on some of that before. But basically what the media scan was doing was enforcing some of the findings that we had seen in the research and reflecting some of what we had known previously. Okay, so we're looking more specifically now at the category of the commercial sex workers, the masseuses, the dancers, and so on. What I have done is pull out some of the key findings. So this is not exhaustive. You know, the fuller study has more information. So 19 of the 35 women were between 18 and 24 years old. 13 were 25 to 35, and we had only one person over 35. 9 of them were masseuses, 15 sex workers, and 9 exotic dancers. Now, 26% of the 35 interviewees said they knew what trafficking was, while 6% didn't, and 3 were not sure of their awareness. But based on the feedback that Claudette Nolan provided, she indicated that they seemed to have limited understanding of what it was. And this you will see borne out in one of the recommendations we have targeted public education messages for some of, you know, these vulnerable groups. In this group, 31% said they had never been, 31 of the 35 said that they had never been trafficked, while we found two women who indicated that they had been. And I think one of those was in the mass use category. 29 of them didn't know anybody who had been trafficked, and two did. Right. So we were, it was interesting to see that the theory was that female sex workers were no longer as vulnerable as the masseuses, because the coercion element was less there. They are more experienced for the most part, so better able to discern, you know, what the opportunities that are being put before them. So we move now to the MSM category. Four of the 20 men were masseurs, 14 sex workers, and two exotic dancers. 12 of them, 18 to 24, 6, 25 to 35, 1 over 46. We had overall, as it said, men who have sex with men, but we had three who were transgender in the group as well. Now, in terms of awareness, 90% of the 20 males said they were aware of trafficking. One wasn't sure, and one didn't respond. But we had to flag the concern that some of the men, we didn't get the sense that they clearly understood, even though that they said they did. Because when you ask them to explain some of the things, or just give their understanding of what it is, it didn't quite match up. So, yeah, that was the issue. Now, I initially, when we were tabulating the results and I saw this, 90% said that they had been trafficked. And to me, that was a high number. Dr. Dunn was saying that for her, it wasn't so surprising because based on the group, you know, at times, these risks face them. So one person said that he had not been, and the other person had a yes or no response, so we couldn't really gauge from that. But when we applied the classification for trafficking, 16 of the 18 did seem to, you know, fit the criteria for trafficking, so that's still a significant percent. One of the other things of note was where, because you have trafficking at the different levels, nationally and internationally, and with the MSM population, we found it happening at both levels. So some say, four males said that they had been trafficked from Kingston to St. Catherine. Mobe had three males that said there had been trafficked to Kingston, and Negril, Ochi, and Mandeville also came up as destinations where trafficking had occurred. Also of note is that some of them were trafficked to other countries, Cayman, Dominican Republic, Panama, and Puerto Rico. You know, and the recruitment, even though I don't have it here, but usually they were recruited by friends. You know, somebody who knows somebody said, similar to the video you saw, maybe you get more money if you go dance in Panama. And them say, all right, I'll go and try it. And then when they reach now, they can't come back because them documents get taken away or things like that. Many of them had challenges coping with the experience. One of the things, and this may not be the politically correct thing to say, but many persons sort of assume, take an attitude that MSMs may not are tough, But they have been seriously impacted by some of the trafficking experiences. And what they did mention was that they ended up turning more to drugs to cope with some of the experiences based on that. So a lot of them smoking, marijuana, grabber, that was the more accessible drug of choice. A few sought counseling. And, you know, one or two just use different things to motivate them. Also of interest is the health status. Now, during the trafficking experience, four men developed STIs. I think one of them indicated HIV of the four. And so one of these said he did not get medical treatment while the others did. Of the other 17, we had no response. I particularly picked out this other slide about employment options after trafficking because I think if we're looking at the issue in a sustainable way, we need to look at where people go if they come out or when they come out and desire to move on. And here, of the 16 males, 7 said that they moved into sex work after their trafficking experience. 3 went into the service industry in the hotel sector, if I remember correctly. 2 said, you know, they switched completely, did plant and machine operating, and 1 was self-employed. We didn't really get that much, really. Well, for the woman, they pretty much stayed where they were in terms of employment. So I'm winding down now to some of the recommendations that we put forward coming out of what the information showed. In terms of the media, there was clearly a demand for ongoing sensitization of journalists about human trafficking. That is something that I know based on my experience in the newsroom and what I observe now, that there's a high turnover rate in the media houses now. So you have to constantly be working with groups and teams to share information about how to report on trafficking. And also, where possible, build partnerships and opportunities for journalists to investigate and report more on human trafficking. We also had the need for public education initiatives, and journalism would be a part of that overall frame. For the CSWs, there's a great need for specific public education messages. You know, telling them, sensitizing them to the risk of trafficking and understanding how you can come out or preventing you going into that sort of situation. I was very happy when I saw the work that Reverend Lewis was doing, you know, providing support services and helping men and women to transition out of trafficking, but one or two NGOs is not enough to really significantly address the issue. So we need to beef up the support services. And here we have provide peer-to-peer counseling and mentoring. And this was something that quite a bit of both the MSMs and the CSWs said, because once training some of the persons who've had or experienced some of these circumstances, once you've been there, you understand better. And you can really share as a peer to help the person make the transition. So somewhat similar for MSMs, increased social support, public education, and sensitization materials. But I wanted also to stress this one, organized dialogue sessions between MSMs and law enforcement personnel to address some of the barriers to reporting trafficking among this group. I don't know if you guys understand the brevity of this one. Because we know our culture, and let's be honest, and I'm not knocking the police force, but sometimes some of the policemen don't want to have anything to do with the gay men, using the polite term. And so having that dialogue, and some of the gay men also don't want to have anything to do with the police. And so when they have trafficking or have been trafficking, they're not going to report it because they know they're going to face, what's the word? Disrespect from the police and, you know, what's discrimination. Thank you very much, Ms. Veer. Right, so this is something that we really have to look at also in a serious way. My concluding thoughts. For me, well, this is a bit biased, but and I'll admit it, as a communicator, I, of course, want to see greater awareness on the issue. Things are starting to change from 2003, when I thought we had nothing like that here. But I don't think we are progressing enough, and I don't think culturally we are placing enough emphasis on it. It's still something that I think is one of the by the ways. And this has to change because it has serious impact for us as a society. Tackling the cultural barriers which restrict speaking out on these issues. A lot is happening now, really, the whole issue of, if you've been following the case of the Moravian Church, people say their name, certain social media campaigns encouraging people to not be ashamed to name the perpetrators. And I think, while I might not endorse everything along that line, I think we have to look at more breaking down some of these cultural barriers so people can feel comfortable reporting, you know, trafficking and abuse. Two last things, partnerships. I have learned in my 11 years with Panos the beauty and value of partnerships, especially strong strategic partnerships. There are some things that an NGO can get done, the advocacy, the lobbying, but working maybe with the government, different arms of the government to push, providing the data and so on. One of the things in the bigger study is even looking at how the government works and ensuring that there is a broader join-up approach throughout the government. You have a department, yes, that deals with trafficking, but it has to be more mainstreamed and integrated across government policy. So forming strategic partnerships is key. And lastly, money. Met the mayor Gallup. Funding to do more on trafficking is critical and it's important. I know that Panos and IGDS, the partners basically, are interested in some of the work, the follow-up work that needs to be done to address what the research has shown. You know, developing projects that really will have an impact on the ground. But funding has to be gained for that. I am done. So I will open the floor to questions, comments. You know, let's talk about what has come out.
All right, I will start off.
Oh, we had one?
We have a roving mic?
Yes.
Thank you. of young people who were missing.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think that that's very well.
Yes. But go ahead, go ahead. All right, let me start with your last question first. We did have a slide with some statistics looking at the numbers up to, I think it was 2015, right? What, Kim, I don't know if we can flash back to that slide. So this was directly from, I think, the police. So we did touch on it a little bit, but the more recent data over the last year and a half wouldn't be there. Let me see. No, not that one. Earlier. Keep going. Yeah, no, wait. Yes. So we had... this slide shows a bit about how many were still missing based on the assessment. We had 10% of the overall study still missing. And I think there were, and 7 at the time were dead. So the breakout is not, I mean, you can't fully say exactly if it was totally trafficking, but these are the statistics that we had at the time. We see though 1,000% increase, so we're noting that because there has been more sensitization, more of the cases are being classified and documented as trafficking over the time. Jessica, I don't know if you want to add anything. All right, before I answer you, though, I didn't answer the lady about the bureau. In terms of what I'm aware with the, thank you, Vera, for coming. I'm from the same parish, so I'm happy to see you represented. right, in terms of awareness of what the government is doing, I know that there's a trafficking person's desk in the Ministry of Justice that deals with a lot of the issues. And I am sure that they work with the Bureau of Gender Affairs, but I don't know the details of how that collaboration
is. National anthropology.
Right.
And I think we shared at the beginning of the presentation a name, which is Ms. Keisha West, who persons can contact.
Okay, right. So I'll come to you. I'll just answer this question here. You are asking about the perception that commercial sex workers were less vulnerable. Claudette, do you want to help me on that one? Because since you collected the data. We had a question from here.
Good morning. Mm-hmm. Just wanted to underscore the point that we need to be policy coherence. And I feel
morning. Training them in what?
Counseling.
Yeah.
Also, I was wondering how many of the, are all of them sims, homosexual or some men, straight men who are
Okay. Well, actually, we didn't make the distinction, we didn't explore the reasons behind, so I'm not sure. But in terms of the occupations for those persons who've been trafficked, counseling could be one option. But one of the challenges that we see, and I'm basing this on work that Panos has done with commercial sex workers, because we had done some research on the oral testimonies of commercial sex workers. And some of the women say they want to leave prostitution, but at the same time, you have to find something that will pay you as much. That's the reality of it. So unless you can train them and transition them into something that is comparative, that's part of the challenge. What, I'm not sure I understand what you mean by a real... Okay. Well, the National Task Force primarily would deal with the awareness, a lot of the awareness issues. And as you'll see, the media has also been covering the issue. In terms of targeted public education, IGDS, this is one of those forms, trying to share and spread the message. A part of the study is a communication strategy for trafficking. So that's there to be implemented. I'm not sure what else the task force has in place at this time. Can you add anything to that?
In terms of the legislation, recent amendments,
Hold on there. All right. Because we have one comment after.
Yes. The reason why I asked the question is because this is a very, very important subject. And I don't know how much, you know, people really give attention to it. Especially there are people, although you have all the information, you have the MBA, you have the participants, you have people working, you have research, but there are people who really don't believe, don't know that it exists. And it is. And one of the things that earlier in your, when you were talking, you mentioned certain things. Now, as you realize that I'm from the tradition, we have been working civil on that subject. But really, within our group, and this is the reason why I was so eager to attend this meeting, to hear and to see people, to know what we are doing, and to realize that how we can be in partnership with other groups where we can really talk about the subject. Because we talk, we talk to our ladies, we talk both about it, but people, they do not realize that. Because we talk about one of the reasons of human trafficking, we talk about poverty. We talk about not only poverty, but also people want to have a better life. And that's why the government come into it, where we are asking that the government needs to be looking at it and how we can educate, especially all young people. Mm-hmm. And you know, that is very important. And then the other thing again that I want to mention is that the trafficking, they are not far from us. They are right there. And people need to look, you know, they are right beside you. It is a person, it is a friend, it is an uncle. And when I was carrying on in all the countries, I hear in Kingston, you see a better life, see people, they are looking, they have job, they have this, they have that. But in the country, there, people coming from Kingston and going there and ask them, why don't you send her to Kingston? And not asking, not finding out, where are you going? Where are you staying? Mm-hmm. You know, and it can be a uncle, it can be a friend. So we really need people to be aware of it and to know that it is important. Wherever you are, working, whatever you are doing, people need to know that even if you are not a part of a group, but you need to know even after this meeting that wherever you are, you need to help people to know and to understand.
Thank you. Thanks so much.
This is very important. Yes. All of us are vigilant.
I see your hand in a shot.
I want to put that underlining the point that I was having shown on the calling as a media, that it is the top child trafficking, that's to say under 18, is really the critical area where radical based on that tier 3 position in 2003. And as she says, it is something that is actually missing because very often it is very critical for community members who are starting the trafficking. But I want to say I belong to the National Task Force on Trafficking of Women, so that I want to tell you a little bit more about it than your colleague Margaret did.
not today, not today, so.
Not that company.
Right.
Yes, but I'm saying it's one which I think is our support. We benefit from a lot in terms of your discussions and your recommendation.
Mm-hmm.
It's an area of intense concern, and I do not be more to speak as well.
Thank you very much. Jessica, after there is that name.
One of the most traumatic experiences that they suffer from, and we have a statistic reported as to how much actually, you know, come back from the experiences we can.
From what I recall in pulling the data together, one of the major post-traumatic experiences depression. A lot of them were severely depressed, and hence they're resorting to, you know, drugs to help them come out of that sort of state. In terms of how many came back, the breakout of that, I'm trying to think through. Well, most of them, maybe only three sort of stayed in the places where they were trafficked. Most of them returned to their original area, from what I recall.
Mm-hmm.
Good morning. A lot of it is economic because, as was indicated, I mean, I'm from the country. I'm a country girl from way up in the hills in Moko. And, I mean, think of it this way. I may want to come in and live with my auntie because I may be able to get a job or go to school because of access. But at the same time, one, it could be what I'm forced to do within the home there that is the coercion, and you don't, I think some of it is stigma too, because to go back to country, what is there? That is how a lot of people think, because you won't have the opportunities that you will have in the urban areas. So that is part of you know, the excitement of usually the urban area, or the potential to earn a bit more. That is my take on it. There may be more that others could add. I also wanted to add two things, which I didn't mention in my discussion, but which I think are also fruitful for us to think about. While we focused on vulnerable, particularly vulnerable groups, I just want to underscore that as we are seeing now, with a lot of the, since the start of the year, coming from December, a lot of the young girls being kidnapped and missing and so on, really underscores that maybe it's getting worse, and in terms of this whole boosting systems like the Ananda Alert, where you can very, very quickly respond, we have to be very, very vigilant. I mean, even this morning, we were having a conversation when I was dropping my daughter and son to school, because she's to take a taxi to her evening class, and her father was saying, no, go and pick her up, or take a public taxi in quotation. And he was saying, no, 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 they're taking away a lot of girls now. I don't want her to go on the taxi. You know, so it's a lot that parents have to be facing now in this culture of fear. And I really think we have to look at what can we do. I told him they were traveling in groups, and they would take the number of the taxi and text it to me when they leave, and so on and so forth. So being more vigilant, but nonetheless, we have to look at that because it's very urgent, very emerging. And I was fascinated by the findings from the faith-based organization and the church community that Reverend Fowler did. Because when I looked through her section of the study, the lack of awareness in the church and the lack of action is, and this is my word, it's not in the study, but it's horrific. I'm saying, we the church is such a strong part of Jamaican society. It can't be that so many of the leadership and so many members are not aware and not interested and not doing. You know, so I hope that there's another opportunity for Reverend Fowler to be able to share that and we continue the discussion, because personally I want to see that discussion take place, especially in light of all that's happening now with our society and some of the church factors.
Hello.
All right, we have one up here as well. So once you are finished, do that and then we come.
I was just wondering if you're aware of any programs for mentorship and mentees for trafficking victims, especially with agencies such as the NYS and the Office of the Children's Advocate, where young people and children are associated with, and if you think this is the next necessary step for consciousness raising about trafficking and trafficking.
And you probably would have to touch base with the, what's the name of the lady in the department here, West? Miss West, Ministry of Justice. She also helps to coordinate a lot of the mentoring and the support.
Two things I wanted to say. I think one of the things,
and but I would like to add to that, though, that in communication, we do look at what's called knowledge, attitude, and practice. It's plenty of things we know, and yet we don't observe. Smoking is bad for us. How many persons still go ahead and smoke? So sometimes they know, but they're still not taking the preventative measures. They're still, you know, going, taking certain taxes and not observing precautions. So how do we push past just the knowledge into behavior change?
Absolutely.
Thank
culture
you very
science,
much. Yes.
A pleasant morning, everyone. On the behalf of the Institute for Gender and Development Studies Research Days Planning Committee, I would like to thank the following persons for being here today. Our guest presenter, Mrs. Indy Lafayette, thank you. A special thank you for accepting the invitation to deliver the lecture despite the short notice. We are extremely fortunate that as a member of the research team on human trafficking in Jamaica, you agreed to assist following the unavoidable absence of our original speaker, Reverend Dr. Margaret Fowler. To our chair, Dr. Jessica Dunn, who was also a member of the research team, we appreciate the additional insight you provided on the study and impact of human trafficking on the Jamaican society. Thank you. Thank you to Professor Eldemir Shearer, Chair of the University Research Day Planning Committee, for providing financial assistance to procure the venue and to provide refreshment to our guests. To our guests, Thank you for attending. I do hope you were fully informed. Finally, thank you to my colleagues from the Gender Society who had volunteered to assist the Institute in fully participating in the University's Research Day. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you. We also have some refreshments at the back. Please feel free to partake. Yes.